So this was a part of my PhD chapter. It was one of the chapters that I was looking into. So my thesis was mainly related to what is money laundering. Now, as everyone knows, it's just an act of giving dirty money a legitimate appearance. The United Nations 2000 Convention defines it in a very fancy way. It says that it's an act of converting or transferring any asset with the knowledge of it being involved with the criminal source, such that you can hide that criminal source. There are several ways to launder money, and one of those methods was using shell companies. So my next question was, what are these shell companies? Now, these are entities with low or no physical presence and economic values. These are also known as front companies or anonymous entities. They're used for legal purposes such as reverse merger, facilitating foreign operations, even holding real estate properties. However, their ease of incorporation, disposability, and anonymity makes them an important vehicle for carrying out illicit activities. I mean, some of the instances for such were their involvement in carrying out like money laundering schemes, such as there was an anonymous firm called Anglo Leasing Incorporation, which was used to launder 24 million euros just for updating passport system in Kenya. These entities have been used for money laundering, sanction evasion, bribery, corruption, and even for financing the acts of terrorism. So therefore, it was important to at least propose a method to identify such entities. My hypothesis while undertaking my research was that these entities can be identified if we have analyzed entities which have already been accused or identified in money laundering cases. And the risk my geographical location for conducting this research was UK. Again, UK was one of the first countries in the world to come up with a public register of ownership for companies. However, it was identified to be involved with incorporation of shell companies, which were used for laundering 80 billion pounds. And that was between a period of 2010 to 2014, whereby a lot of entities with owners from former Soviet Union were used to launder funds from Russia to the United Kingdom. So there was a dichotomy of like between the theoretical standards and the observable activity, which made it a very interesting choice to like carry out my research work. Again, for this purpose, for doing this research, I was helped by Transparency International UK, which provided me with a list of 800 shell companies which were identified in different cases of corruption. Again, these entities were used for a lot of illicit activities, but laundering of funds was a central theme. Amongst these 800 companies, I chose to consider the limited company type. The reason for choosing them were because there was a lot of information available related to them, and I chose these entities. Information about these entities was collected from OpenRefine, which is a corporate database, again, the privately held corporate database. Apart from this, like other information was extended using sources such as Every Politician, Open Sanctions, and UK Companies House. UK Companies House is a UK corporate registry, which was used to extend information about the appointment of directors in the companies. Again, all this information was collected and refined in a data wrangling tool called OpenRefine. Given that my background is not in data science, it was something new for me. I think I started with graphs as recent as 2020. So it was something really challenging, but I think what helped me was one of the reports which I came across, which was by International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, whereby they showcased the use of Neo4j. And I think that's where I was inspired to use Neo4j for my research. And I use the information that I had collected to import that information on the Neo4j graph database platform. The graph topology or the database schema that I adopted for my particular research was as follows, as you can see in the slide, whereby the cases for which the companies were identified were the root node and the companies were linked to it. Again, each company will have executives, they'll have registered addresses. Similarly, they'll have previous addresses. As part of the properties, I also incorporated additional information about nationality of directors, their tenure of operation, and so forth. Once the data was on Neo4j, I think I could run several search queries. Again, when the data is not on a graph database platform or when you cannot visualize it, there are a lot of queries which you cannot perform or identify useful information. After running some search queries, I think I got some valuable insights. From my data itself, I found that there was an individual who was found to have an executive appointment in 139 entities. Now, again, an individual having an appointment in 139 entities at the same time is a red flag. So I was quite intrigued to investigate more, and I found that out of my entire data set, only 51 companies had a official owner, and the rest of the companies did not have any owners associated with them, which was quite insightful. It showed the gap that was there between the theoretical standards and the observable activity, at least in the UK. Moving forward, I did run a path finding algorithm just to check the links between companies and as to see how the companies are related with each other. Again, this was something that was quite insightful for me. Upon using the data science and graph algorithm app on Neo4j platform called Euler, I did run a combination of graph algorithms related to similarity, community detection, and centrality. Again, since there was nothing in the literature which specified about the combination of algorithms that I could use, I just tried a bunch of algorithms which I'm still working on, and I came up with certain scores. I imported these scores on another platform which is for running decision trees, and I got my performance metrics. Again, the performance metrics that I obtained was within the range of 87% to 97% using different combination of algorithms. Now, this is setting as a base for future research work. Again, it's not stating anything in particular, but it's a base whereby future research could incorporate such hybrid techniques involving graph algorithms and supervised learning. For me, I think the most important outcome of this was learning how to use graphs, incorporating that into my research. And moreover, I was using data which was all publicly available information. I think what in future research one could benefit what can from is using information related to these entities' banking transactions. I think incorporating that information with the information that I've used can provide better results. Moreover, maybe in future, adopting alternative database schemas can also help a lot. And there was one more thing that I did wasn't able to do was incorporating map coordinates, because what happens is if there is a variation in the addresses, I would not have been able to identify that at the present. Again, it's something starting road for me, and I'm still learning, and I think like it's helping me a lot for my research. So yeah.